Series 2, Number 9. Masada, an interview with Professor Yigael Yadin. As you hear the recording, listen particularly for the following. 1. What moved Professor Yadin most about the speech to the defenders of Masada? 2. What was promised to the volunteers for the Masada expedition, and what did they get? 3. What were the great moments of the excavations for the volunteers at the Masada expedition? 4. How were the remains of the Jewish defenders of Masada discovered? 5. What was the last rite for the defenders of Masada? Here to introduce the recording is Dr. Samuel J. Citron.
Professor Yigael Yadin, whom you will hear on this recording, was formerly the chief of staff of the Israel Defense Forces. Now he is the head of the Department of Archaeology of the Hebrew University in Jerusalem. He is world-renowned for his many achievements in his field. He brought the Dead Sea Scrolls to Jerusalem. He headed the expeditions of Hatzor in the north. He brought to light the Bar Kokhba letters hidden in the caves of the Judean desert. The most dramatic and the most meaningful, particularly for Jews, was the 11-month-long expedition which Professor Yadin led at the rock fortress of Masada overlooking the Dead Sea, where were uncovered the physical evidences of the heroic last stand of the Jewish zealots against the Romans in the year 73 Common Era. Here is the story of the expedition at Masada, told to us by Professor Yigael Yadin.
One of the strangest phenomena in human history is no doubt the fight of the Jewish people throughout its history for its spiritual independence, and always the few against the many. And there's no doubt in my mind that one of the most important, heroic, alas, tragic episode in this fight is the story of Masada. After all, in 73 AD, 3 years after the temple was destroyed by Titus, Jerusalem was burned, when arches of triumph were erected in Rome to commemorate this great victory of Rome over Judea, and when coins with inscription Judea Capta were in currency throughout the Roman Empire, yet at one spot and one spot only in Masada, in this rock fort overlooking the Dead Sea, 960 Jews, zealots, men, women and children were defying the whole might of Rome. But when they were encircled by the crack 10th Legion, headed by General Silva, and when the end was near and they knew they wouldn't be able to hold any more, they decided, as all we know, to take their lives in their own hands and die free people rather than to submit to the yoke of the Roman. I believe everybody, I can testify about myself, from childhood, I was very moved by the story of Masada, the way it is told by Josephus Flavius, the Jewish historian, the only, in fact, source, the only historian which talks about it. Particularly, I was moved by the speech of the leader of these people called Elazar Ben Yair. I say the speech of Ben Yair, obviously it's the words which were put into his mouth by Josephus. But I believe that in the nucleus of that speech was actually the words which Ben Yair spoke. I was moved not so much by the philosophy, not so much by the historical description which are embodied in this speech, but rather by the human element, because I thought this human parts were perhaps the most genuine of the lot. That is to say, when Ben Yair said to all his people, when he was trying to persuade them to do this terrible thing as quick as possible, when he said to them, you must do it as quick as you can, before you will see your children, you'll hear your children crying, daddy, daddy, and you will not be able to help them. before you'll see your wife violated and you'll be helpless. And therefore, in fact, when in 1963, when I was asked by the archaeological institutions of Israel to head the expedition to Masada, I considered myself, in fact, very privileged. Because Masada, for all of us, is not just another archaeological site. In a way, if you like, we may call it a mausoleum of the nation's martyrs. And I think this is the main reason why I decided to excavate Masada not in the ordinary way, but to ask for volunteers to come. I thought this place deserved a different type of people to work. To our great amazement, nevertheless, in response of a very short article in some papers in the world asking for volunteers, we had a response of thousands of volunteers from 28 countries, Jews and non-Jews, all coming and flocking to help us in the work of Masada. They came from all walks of life, from beatniks to professors, although sometimes it was very difficult to know by the look who was who. And we promised them bed food and bed lodgings, and needless to say that we kept our promises, and nevertheless they came. And I'm saying this because I calculated that we concluded the excavations of Masada in 11 months of very hard work. But I calculated that were it not for the volunteers, it would have taken us 25 years of normal archaeological years of excavations. Really, they worked with zeal, and it shows again, it was very encouraging, even in these troubled days, that when you have something that people think that it is important, that it has a challenge, they'll come and work and volunteer to work for it. When we went to Masada, we knew from Josephus' history and from previous surveys that we are going to encounter and find Herod's buildings. Herod, King Herod the Great, was the first to fortify and build Masada as a potential asylum for himself. We knew that. But we were asking ourselves, what are we going to discover, archaeologically speaking, about the last days before Passover 73? That is to say, what are we going to discover, archaeologically speaking, relics which belong to the Zealots? Because of them, in fact, we went to Masada. And I can say right away that although we found in Masada beautiful palaces built by Herod with mosaic floors, multicolored, with frescoes, nevertheless, the great excitement, the great moments of excitement in the excavations were not those moments, at least as Jews, not archaeologically. And I would say as human beings, perhaps, not only as Jews. The great moments of the excavation were when we encountered the relics of those last moments of those people who really turned Masada into a symbol. They were not beautiful, but they spoke to us. They had a message in them much bigger than the beautiful mosaics. A burnt layer with ashes in which we found coins with Hebrew inscription for the freedom of Zion, coins actually struck in this very war against the Romans, or remains of sandals and clothing of women and children burnt. And we knew exactly who were the people to whom these relics belonged. These were, in fact, the greatest moments of the excavation. Altogether, at the end of the excavation, I may say that this was perhaps the most difficult excavations I ever took part in. It was very difficult physically, but definitely it was the most rewarding at the same time, because this type of excavation, when you excavate a relic of our past, has more of a message, more of a story to tell us also about the present and about the future than any other place we excavate. Now the message is a very simple one. We saw now, and the excavation showed us, that this legend, so to say, that story of Masada was true. We have all the evidence for that now. And I would say that the message of Masada to us, to the Jewish people, to people in Israel, is that Masada is not only a symbol of heroism, but it's also a reminder. It's also
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.